So last time we learned about the process of row operations to make one matrix into an echelon form and further into reduced echelon form. And also we thought about this pivots, which are the leading entry when we obtain the echelon form. Right? So the leading entry was the first non-zero entry in each row, right? Then, in the echelon form, every leading entry is called a pivot, and then the position of the pivots, or where we find these pivots in our matrix was really important. And then, in practice, when we obtain the pivot over here, like these two pivots, or maybe these three pivots, for example, in this example. So in that case, the variables corresponding to these pivots are the basic variables, and then all the other variables that doesn't contain any pivots along its corresponding columns, right? We don't see any pivots along this vertical vector corresponding to x2. So that was called a free variable, right? And then, and then given these matrices, we have three variables, but also we have the last column, which is corresponding to our constant values. And so, in case we have a pivot, like this guy, so this guy is a pivot we have, if this entry is a 4, and then if the last column has the pivots, and then it means this linear system has no solutions at all, right? Because it's like 0 times x1 and 0 times x2, 0 times x3 equals non-zero. So we don't have any control, like, so always the left-hand side will be 0, but right-hand side will be non-zero. So, it will always be false, regardless of what values to choose for our variables of an x1, x2, and x3. So if we find this kind of column, this kind of equation or rows in our echelon form, and then that's when we conclude that our linear system has no solutions at all. Okay, then we consider the possible patterns of these pivot positions. If we have the same number of equations and the variables, in this case, because we have the last column as these constant values from the right-hand side of these equations. If we have three equations, and then if we had a three variable, and then the number of columns will be 4, or 3 plus 1 equals 4, right? And then we also consider some other cases where we have three variables. So in this case, we were able to see a few different cases that are possible in terms of the number of solutions we have in this equation, depending on the position of these pivots, right? Okay, then we can also think about these kind, it is a little bit long and thin kind of matrix. For example, so in this case we have, don't even need the last row, three equations, but we have two variables of an x1 and x2, right? And then this is the last column corresponding to the constant. So in this case, you can also think about the patterns of our pivots, right? So in this case, suppose we have a pivot somewhere here, then maybe somewhere here. And then, suppose we have a zero here. In this case, our staircase shape will be something like this, right? So in this case, do we have a solution or not? Do we have a solution? Because we don't see any kind of rows, like all zeros except for the last entry, which is non-zero. in that case, we don't see such a pattern, so we can guarantee that we have a solution. And in this case, we have a unique solution or infinitely many solution. So in other words, we have a free variable or not, right? So we have a true variable, right? And then each variable will has the pivots in these each of these two columns. Okay, so in this case, it's the case of having a unique solution, right? But if we think about the other patterns, right? So we have a pivot here, and also pivot here. In that case, our staircase shape will be something like this. So in that case, we see that we have no solution at all, right? Because we see this kind of row in the second row, right? Or the second equation. And then also, suppose we have a pivots here, and probably that's it. I mean, suppose we have no other pivots in this case. And that means our staircase shape is something like this. So, in other words, we see all zeros here. Okay. In that case, the staircase shape is really simple one. So in this case, our staircase shape will be just this guy, right? So in this case, the last two rows are all completely zeros, right? Yeah, is that yeah such a case? And then in this case, we have a solution because we don't see any row like this, right? And then at the same time, is the solution unique or not? So it is not. In other words, we have an infinitely many solution because for this variable, it has a pivot. So it is a basic variable, but x2 doesn't have any pivots in the corresponding column. So in this case, we have the free variable. And that means we have an infinitely many solution. Right? Okay, and then redraw these cases, so this case, where we have a three equation and x1, x2, this is the constant one, and then, so in this case, we have more number of the equations, I mean more equations than the variable, so we have two variable and three equation, in these cases, generally we don't have any solutions at all, right? So we know that if we have more equations than the number of variables, and then in that case we usually have no solution zero, right? So in that case, what will be the pattern for our pivot positions? So it will be something like this. So it will be a little bit of a commonly found pattern that we would see in terms of a pivot position. So in that case, yeah, so the staircase shape would be something like this, right? So in this case, we see 0, 0, and non-zero. And thus, we will have no solution at all, right? Okay. And that was it for this second chapter, I mean, 1.2. Okay, and then let's move to the next chapter of 1.3. So now in this chapter, we study a vector and also the elements in this linear algebra. So up to this, so far we thought about the linear system, right? And then I converted it into a matrix, as an augmented matrix. then we did a row operation. But in this case, in this chapter, we consider this vector, and also, interestingly, we will understand the vector space, like the space where these vectors are living in. Okay, so as I mentioned probably last week, when talking about the vector, we will, by default, we discuss or we can treat them as a column vector, which is a vertical curve shape as a vector. In this case, if we have two entries, then it is a two-dimensional vector. Then, a set of all the vectors, basically, you think of all the possible two-dimensional vectors, and then collect them into one single, like a big set. Okay? And that set is called this R2. So, R2. So that means that it is a square, right? So it means R times R, and this is a real number, okay? Just a real number, and another real number. So it is considering all the possible combinations of the first real number and the second real number, and that is corresponding to the first entry and then the second entry. Okay? So that way, the entire space containing all the possible two-dimensional vectors, we are mainly considering the real numbers, but not a complex numbers, at least in this semester. Okay? So in linear algebra, we usually consider only the real numbers. Okay? So that's why you see R here, and then R squared, or R2 would be entire two-dimensional space, containing all the possible two-dimensional vectors. Okay. And then, we think about a few basic operations about these vectors. So, considering the two-dimensional vector, suppose we have a u, and u1 and u2, and also we have a v, v1 and v2. So, let's think about these two-dimensional vectors, and then if these two vectors are the same, then it means that if it is a 2, it is 5, then this vector should be exactly the same, which means it should have 2 and 5 in the first and the second entry. Okay, so that is the notion of being equal between the two vectors. And then we can think of the summation or addition of these two vectors, right? So 1, 2 plus 3, 5, then it will be 4, 7, right? So it will be addition between the two vectors. And then if we subtract it, then we can easily compute it. Okay, so that is the summation of these two vectors. Then we think about these scalar multiples of a particular vector. And that means, suppose we have this single vector, and then consider it's a scalar multiple by a vector of maybe 4. And so in this case, we just multiply this scalar with each element in our vector, which results in 4 and 8. That's our resulting vector. So that is called a scalar multiple. And then it is just represented as this C and U. And I'm not sure. I haven't clarified this, but in terms of the mathematical notation, like using these alphabets. C, use U and V as the two example of a vector. And then also C here as a scalar value. So as you can see, if we see these are boldface lowercase letter, okay, and then it means it is a vector. Okay? It is a vector, and then it has this mathematical notation of having boldface, but they are lowercase letters. Okay, then this is also lowercase letter, but it's just a plain font, not a bold font, right? So in this case, it is representing a scalar vector. Okay. And so we have two lowercase letters, whether you say bold in case of a vector, and scalar in case it's just a plain font. And then also, what if we use the what about the EM are capital letters, like A, maybe B, and so on. So these are the capital letters when they are a matrix. So this is just a notational, yeah, some notations that we consistently use in this class. Okay. So because we studied this scalar multiple of a particular vector and also addition of these two vectors, then we can easily compute this, right? So we first compute scalar multiple and also another scalar multiple, and then just add these two vectors together. Okay? And then now, when thinking about their geometric relationships, so these two dimensional vectors like 1 and 2, then this guy can be represented geometrically in these two dimensional space where we have these two axes, and then this vector will be corresponding to this point of having the coordinate of 1, 2, right? And this this is a vector, so we consider this vector starting from a 0, right? And so we studied the scalar multiple and the vector addition. So in the case of a scalar multiple, for example, by just multiplying it by 3, and then it's corresponding to stretching the length of the vector while maintaining the same direction of the initial vector, right? So the resulting coordinate will be 3, 6. So far, quite easy. Then consider this as u, and suppose we have another vector, maybe 3 and 5. So in this case, let's consider this vector addition. And then we know that this resulting vector will be something like 1, 2. We have this vector, and 3, 5. Let me just change the example so that we have a different direction. 3, 2. Okay. In this case, it's 3, 2. So we have this vector, right? So this is u and v. Then the resulting addition between these two vectors will be this quite easy one. So we draw this parallelogram, and then we look for this this third point, right? That creates this parallelogram, and then this one will be our resulting vector of these two vector additions. Right? Okay, so that is a geometric description or interpretation or understanding about this basic operations of a scalar multiple and also a vector addition. We have a nice figure here that describes the addition of the vectors. Okay, and then extending the dimension of the vector into like n. So we can of course think about the three-dimensional vector, and these three-dimensional vectors are living in this R3. And then what if we have an n-dimensional vector? So n is another constant number. So n can be like 100 or thousands or even more. In that case, we can consider this Rn as the entire space where n-dimensional vectors are all living in. And using this vector addition and the scalar multiples, we see various important properties. So they are really simple ones, but they are quite useful. So we will often use it in really crucial moments. So this one is about what kind of law or mathematical relationship or properties is it called in Korean? 영어로 보자. Change요? 좋아. So, maybe I think. I think it's commutative law. Commutative law. Commutative law. So this is a in Korean it's a gohan bokshik. And then it is true in the case of a better edition. And then this one is called what? Association means some kind of relationship, right? So I am associated with the computer science department. So that means I am related to the, this department. Okay? So that way we are relating these two first, or we are relating these two first. So we can freely relate the vector additions by changing or freely choosing their orders of how they are related. Okay, and then in this case, so we have a vector u, and then this one is a zero. Then so this is true, right? So it's a really trivial, but this one has one little flaw or a testing typo in this equation. And what is that typo? So because we are studying the vector, when thinking about the zero, we have scalar zero, but also zero vector, or vector zero, like 0, 0, right? So when representing this, we especially represent it as this boldface zero, right? So you will see these are boldface zeros in the later slides, but this one should be this boldface one, because it is a vector, right? So that means, suppose we have this vector, and then you want to add it with the scalar, and in this case, it is not even defined, right? So when doing this vector addition, it is only defined when we add the same dimensional vector. So it is two-dimensional vector, and this one is a one-dimensional vector. So it is this vector addition is not possible. So that way this zero should be actually zero vector that has the same dimension, right? And also 1, 2 plus maybe 0, 0, 0. It is not also possible either, right? Because the dimension of these two are different, right? Yeah. And then of course 1, 2 and maybe 3, 4, 5. And so such a vector addition is not possible either, right? Because they are having a different dimension. Okay, and then we can define this vector subtraction of we are subtracting the same vector, and then u minus u, and then it can be represented as this u plus minus 1 minus 1 times u, right? So it will generate this zero vector. So it's all really easy, right? But we can think about this negative u as minus 1 or negative 1 times u. Okay? So this can be viewed as a scalar multiple and then a vector addition. Okay, and then when it comes to this scalar multiple of the summation of these two vectors, and then they are distributed, right? So that way it is called a distributed law. Okay? And also in Korean, what is it called? Okay? And then such a distributed law can also be true when distributing this scalar multiple as a summation of these two numbers. Okay? So it can also be distributed so that we obtain this. Yep. So these are really easy. Then these two are also true. So it's like 3 times 4 maybe u. So u is, for example, 1, 2 as a vector. Okay? So it is just the same as 12 times 1, 2. Okay, so it was really easy so far. And then now let's study really, really important up operation in this linear algebra called linear combination. Linear combination. So linear combination is simply the summation of our input vectors. So suppose we are given these input vectors. So we are given a multiple different vectors initially, and then we first do the scalar multiple on each of them with the different scaling factor, and then just add them together. So that is called a linear combination. And so if you remember like linear system and think about the each equation we have, like 3x plus 4, y equals maybe 5, and then the left hand side, 3x plus 4y is actually a linear combination of these two given variable of an x and y, right? But now we think about the linear combinations of the vector. So that means in the place of an x and y, we now have a vector, okay? So like 1, 2 times maybe 3 plus 5 and 3, 2. So this can be viewed, this is a one simple example of a linear combination of the vector. This is the, this is really an important form that, that we handle in this class. Okay? So in other words, it is for the linear combination of these two given vectors, okay, by using these as a particular scalar multiple associated with each vector. And also in this case, these 3 and 5 are called weights, or it is also called coefficients. Coefficients. Okay. So in Korean, 이거를 뭐라고 그러죠? Weight가 가중치라고 그러고, 혹은 coefficient는 배수죠, 그죠? 그래서 이런 이름으로. Okay. And these weights that forms this linear combination can be any real number. So of course we consider only the real numbers. And also, is it possible to have a zero coefficient somewhere in this linear combination coefficient? So for example, so what if we have a zero here? And then can we still call it as a linear combination? And then the answer is yes. Okay. So the coefficient or weight can be any real numbers, including zero as our coefficient. Okay. Okay. And then using this linear combinations of a vector, let's think about this example. So we are given these two vectors, a1 and a2. So initially, when thinking about the linear combination of a vector, so we usually consider these ingredient vector or the initial vectors are already given, okay? And then we consider their linear combination coefficients. So in that case, let's assume that we do not know yet about what the what the value of our linear combination coefficient. So let's consider that linear combination coefficient as maybe x1 and x2. And then, if we think about these linear combinations of these two vectors by using the coefficients of an x1 and x2, right? So we can think of this linear combination of these two vectors. And then, in this example, it is giving this kind of equation. So, here in this case, so x1 and x2 are the two linear combination coefficients, and then this a1 and a2, which are written as a both ways, are the vectors. So they are the vectors, right? So you can think about these two vectors, right? And then, of course, the vector dimension should be the same. So suppose a1 was, in this case, 1, negative 2, negative 5, and 2, 5, 6. And then this equation. In this equation, the left-hand side was a linear combination coefficient, but this linear combination coefficient as our vector should be the same as another vector b. Okay, so here we also we have another typo here. So b should be both ways, okay? Because b should be the vector. Otherwise, it wouldn't be possible to write this equation. Okay, so suppose b is also given as this 7, 4, and negative 3. Okay, so we have another three-dimensional vector on the right-hand side. Then let's think about this equation. So some linear combination coefficient of these two given vectors, and then it should be the same as another given vector. Okay? So in this case, our task is to determine the linear combination coefficient that makes this equation to be true. So we want to we want to make this equation be true, but we have a freedom of choosing whatever values of this linear combination coefficient of x1 and x2 so that we can satisfy this equation. Okay. This is the our new problem when dealing with this vector equation, linear combination. Okay, and then let's just write it down. Let's write this equation down. So we have a linear combination coefficient and the two given vectors, and then that should be the same as another vector called the b. So we have another typo here. It should be b. Okay, and then let's just evaluate these left hand side. Okay, so here. Yeah, we know, we know how to compute this linear combination coefficient, like 2, 4, okay? 12, 8, and then add them together for each dimensional entries, right? So 14, 12, 12, 22. So let's write it down. When having these x1 and x2 as our kind of unknown, but our coefficients, right? In that case, the first vector will be x1, negative x2, negative x, negative 5 times, so this one is x1, and right? So this one will be our first vector. After doing this scalar multiple, and then another one over here will be 2x2, 5x2, 6x2, right? So if we add them together, then we will just add them in the corresponding dimension entries. Okay, so the left-hand side, or the final linear combination result, will be represented as this one. This vector will be our linear, another representation of the linear combination of these two vectors by using these two x1 and x2 as our linear combination coefficient. And then this linear combination, linear combination of these two vectors should be the same as 7, 4, negative 3. So we have another vector on the right-hand side. And then if we see the two vectors equal, like 1, 2, should be equal to maybe some number and another number in this two-dimensional vector, then it's a really easy question of having this exact same values for each dimension, right? So that means this value should be the same as this. This value should be the same as this, right? So let's just write it down in this equation. So we have two three-dimensional vectors, right? Right. So one vector on the left and another vector on the right. Then if we equate them, then this first entry should be the same as 7. This guy should be the same as 4. This guy should be the same as negative. Then these three equations are written here. And now we suddenly see really familiar form of linear system. So we have three equations and two variables, right, of an x1 and x2. And where were these variables coming from? So these two variables of an x1 and x2 were initially placed in the position of this linear combination coefficient of this vector, I mean the linear combination of these two vectors, right? how we solve it? I mean, the technique to solve or to obtain the value of an x1 and x2. Yeah, so the rest of the scenarios will be exactly the same. Yeah, so given this as the linear system, and then we consider this augmented matrix, and then do row operations, then create reduced echelon form. This is our reduced echelon form, and thus we obtain the solution of this x1 being 3, x2 being 2. Okay. So it means, so in this case, so just to make it clear, let's draw this staircase shape. Right. So in this case, so we don't see any of like columns like a 0, 0 and non-zero, so we don't see such a column, such a row, right? So that way we have a solution, right? So the solution exists, and then x1 and x2, so both of them are basic variable because each of them has a pivot, and then the final solution will be the unique, and the unique solution will be this, right? And then this is the solution of this linear system, but at the same time, this linear system is actually equivalent to this single equation that involves these two input vector, and then another vector b, and then considering this a single equation, okay, so that equation should have the solution or the same solution as this, right? Okay. So again, this one is the solution of this linear system, but at the same time, this one will be the solution for this, the very first equation that involves this linear combination of the vector. So if we bring this solution of 3 and 2, then let's just write it here. 3 here, 2 here, right? So that means in order to create, or in order to generate the same vector as a 7, 4, and negative 3, we have to scale the first vector, first given vector, by 3, which means the first vector should be stretched or enlarged with the 3 times the original length of the vector, right? And then the second vector is multiplied by 2, which means it stretched out so that it has the double the original length, right? And then after adding these two vectors together, then it will be the same as 7, 4, negative, right? And then we can think about this in three-dimensional space. So, yeah. So, let's just think about the simple case of like 1, 2, and maybe 3, and 4, 3 times 3.2 is equal to. Something like this, right? So this one will be, the true equation. But suppose we didn't know, we do not know this x1 and x2, okay, which are our linear combination coefficient. And suppose we want to obtain what the values are for this x1 and x2, given this single equation that involves these three vectors. Okay. So in that case, this problem can be viewed as starting with these two vectors of 1, 2, okay, 1, 2 here and 3, 2 here. Okay. So we have these two vectors, right? Then the first vector times 3. That means some vector like this. Then the second vector times 4, which is something like this, right? And then if we add them together, then that vector will be corresponding to this point in our parallelogram that we draw, and this resulting vector should be the same as this vector, 15, 14. Okay. So again, we didn't know these two values, right? So the initial problem setting is we are given these two vectors, for example, and then we have another vector somewhere like maybe here. Okay? So this one will be our b, this one will be a1 and a2. And then we want to make this point as our vertex, vertex in our parallelogram. Okay? In that case, how can we make such a parallelogram? So maybe not good at drawing, but let me try. Yeah, so I am creating this kind of parallelogram so that this vertex coincides with the given vector b. Then such a parallelogram can be represented as this. So the first one, so first vector should be this guy. And then let's think about the scalar multiple, and then what would be the scalar multiple vector to make this red vector. So the red vector seems to be maybe 1.5 times A1, because this length, I suppose this length was maybe maybe 3, then like this vector length looks like 4.5. Okay? So we are stretching the first vector into this red vector. And then such a scalar multiple to create this vector would be some values like 1.5. And then what about the second one? The second one is this vector. So this is another vector in order to create this parallelogram. And then this vector will be so initially, the vector length of an A was that much, and then this vector length is about half of the original length. So this blue vector looks like 0.5 or 1/2 A2. Okay? So in order to make this vertex of this parallelogram as the given vector B, something like this 15, 14, okay? And then we want to find out these two linear combination coefficients which correspond to these ratio of how much we stretch or extend the original length of these two vectors, okay? So this problem of solving this vector equation, where the left-hand side is a linear combination of these two given vectors, and the right-hand side is another given vector. Okay? So this problem, is equivalent to finding out the suitable linear combination coefficient, which works as this stretching or kind of shrinking kind of vector of the original vector length associated with each of these given vectors. Okay? So we are stretching or shrinking the original vector length, and then so that the vertex of our parallelogram coincides or the same as the given vector b. Okay? So that is a kind of geometric interpretation of this of this equation. That is a geometric interpretation, which is really important, but the actual way of solving or finding out these values are just following these row reduction that we just studied in the previous chapter. Okay. And now let's think about this augmented matrix, and then let's imagine it's a linear system. So when thinking about the linear system, the natural way of understanding this linear system was considering individual equations, right? So we have a three equation of x1 to x2 equals 7. So this is the first constraint or the requirement to satisfy, right? And then the second equation is this guy, right? So it is really natural, or we Yeah, we naturally thought about this linear system as row by row, right? Because row corresponds to the initially given equations that we have to satisfy, right? But this augmented matrix or this linear system can be also viewed as one single equation that involves linear combination of the young vector. So remember, this linear system is exactly the same as this single equation that involves linear combination of the vector on the left hand side and then another vector on the right. So in this case, how many equations do we have? So this is just a single equation, just one equation. Okay? So we have one equal sign here. Right? So this is a one equation or single equation. But this single equation is actually involving a vector. Okay? Involving a vector. So given this augmented matrix or this linear system, we can now think about this new version or new perspective of viewing it as a vector equation. I mean the single equation that involves linear combination of the vector. And how we do it is as follows. So this is the first vector that we are given. And then this one is another vector given. And then the third vector that is also given. Then now it is represented as the linear combination of these two vectors, like x1, I'm just rewriting it, the original vector equation, x2 times 2, 5, 6 equals 7, 4, negative 3, right? So this is exactly equivalent to the single vector equation, okay, that involves these vectors. So, yeah. So this is really an important, yeah, perspective or important way of understanding or viewing this property. Okay? So again, we naturally thought about this linear system as having multiple equations. One, another, the third equation that we have, right? But regardless of how many equations we have in our linear system, it can all be represented as a single equation, just one equation. Okay? So if we have a 100 equation, and then still in that case, we can view it as a single equation. So like maybe let's think about the augmented matrix, like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 9, 8, maybe 7, 6, 5, and so on. So suppose we have really many number of equations. Okay? So we have currently 5 equations, but in this case, if we consider it as a vector equation, then we have a 3 equation, and then, no, 3 vectors, then we just consider just a one, yeah, only one equation. That has the linear combination. Yeah, that has the linear combination of these first two vectors, and then that should be equal to the last vector, right? So, yeah, we can convert it always as a single equation that involves these vector linear combination. Okay? And then, yeah, as I mentioned about this interpretation in the geometric high-dimensional space. So in this case, what is the dimension of the input vectors? So all the three vectors are living in R, what? Fine, right? So all three vectors are living in this R space of an R5, right? So even, yeah, although we cannot imagine this a five-dimensional space, but the first vector will be some point in this high dimensional space. So yeah, so we have a origin here, which is a zero vector. Okay, so that is a starting point of a zero vector. And, suppose this guy is our A1. Maybe this guy is A2. Right. So this guy is A1 and A2, and we have a B here. which lives in also in the same dimensional space of this five-dimensional space, and suppose that point is somewhere like here, somewhere over here. Then, yeah. So in this equation, we always have to think about this parallelogram. Then we consider this vector, and then this problem of solving linear this linear system is to find out the scalar multiple of the first vector by this amount, and the second vector by this amount. Okay, so we can always view this linear system as this a single vector equation that creates this parallelogram in our high dimensional space. Okay, so in this case, roughly, the solution for x1 will be something like 0.7, because this is the original length. Then we need this vector, right? So it is about like 0.7 times a1. Then this second vector is a little bit larger than the original vector of a2. So in that case, x2 maybe some value like 1.1, right? So that way we stretch out the second vector. Okay, that way we can create this parallelogram whose vertex is coinciding with the given vector b over here. Okay. So this is a this is I don't think it's difficult to understand. It is quite easy, right? It's really, really important, right? So it's a really key concept that will be used in the rest of today's class and maybe the next few classes we will have. So you have to really clearly understand this. Okay? I mean, in this vector space, and then creating this parallelogram. Any questions so far? Okay, and then back to this question of this viewing augmented matrix as a single vector equation. And we can simply represent it, or simply represent this augmented matrix as this one. So this is a this looks like really simple form, but these are bold faces, right? So these are really the column vectors. So that way we obtain this rectangular augmented matrix. Okay. Then I often use the term called the vector equation. So this is of course an equation, right? So this is an equation, but it involves the vector. Right? So that way we call it as a vector equation. And regardless of how big we have for our linear system, we have so many variables and so many equations. Okay, in any of these cases, it can always be represented as this a single vector equation. Okay, and then its corresponding augmented matrix can be represented as their column vectors obtained from our linear system. Okay, so back to this example. Now, we view this. We can now view this problem in terms of the columns in our augmented matrix instead of a row. Okay. Again, the row corresponds to the individual equation, right? But these columns in our augmented matrix will give a new kind of perspective or a new way of understanding this problem of making. This kind of parallelogram. Okay. Okay. And then now let's think about the new notion called span. Okay. Span. Okay. So. Span is closely related to whether we have a solution or not in our linear system. Okay? So let me give an example here. X1, 2x2 and x1 plus 3x1 plus 6x2. Okay? So let's think about this linear system where we have these two variables and two equations, but I didn't give you the right hand side value yet. Okay? Do not know these values. Okay? So in this case, suppose the first entry was maybe second number so that we can have the solution. Okay? Suppose we want to have the solution, okay? That satisfies both equations. What will be the number here? Well, right? What if we had a 13? We will not have a solution at all, right? We know that, right? So now let's understand it by using from the perspective of a vector equation. So this one is a represented as this x1, x2, plus 84, power 12. Okay? So the left hand side is now a form of a linear combination of these two vectors, right? And then think about the situation where we have the second entry is not yet determined. Okay? Okay. And then the left hand side is basically a linear combination of 1, 2 and it should be 1, 3, right? So 1, 3 and 2, 6. We are thinking of, we are considering the linear combinations of these two vectors, right? Two vectors. And then the third vector should be form of a linear combination of the these two given vectors, right? Right? Then so let me use the finger. Okay? So we are not directly considering this. But let's think about these three-dimensional case. Then maybe we are given another equation like maybe 15 or something. Yeah, something like that. Okay. So we do not yet consider much about the right hand side. Let's think about the left hand side only. And then, I just added another equation here. So now we have a three equation. Okay? And then when thinking about their vector equation, it will be 1, 3, 4. Right? And then 2, 6, and 5. Right? And then again we do not yet think about the right hand side. Okay. Then, just let's focus on the left-hand side, which is the linear combination of these two vectors, okay? So, these two vectors are living in this three-dimensional space. So, so let's assume this three-dimensional space has the origin over here, then maybe this x-axis and y and z-axis, okay? So let's think about this three-dimensional coordinate system or three-dimensional vector space, okay? And then, let's think about this the first and the second vector as so we have an origin here. And then suppose this one is the first vector of 1, 3, 4. Okay? And then let's think about another vector which has the coordinate of 2, 6, 5. Okay? So this one is the first vector, and this one is the second vector, and this one is our origin. So we are given these two vectors. Okay? And then let's imagine the right-hand side vector is somewhere over here, okay? Somewhere over here. And then it is like this vector, so like this, okay? So in that case, what is our problem of solving this linear system? We want to create this vector, okay? This point, given as a right-hand side vector as the vertex of our parallelogram of these two vectors, right? So we stretch freely the first vector, right? And then also we stretch or shrink the second vector freely, right? So that we create the parallelogram that has the vertex as the right-hand side vector, right? So in this case, in this really large three-dimensional space, given these two vectors, we can create this as the vertex of our parallelogram, right? By just stretching or shrinking these two vectors, right? And then what about this point, another point? Right? That point can be also formed as the vertex of our parallelogram, right? But what if we have another vector, b, which is like a little bit like off from this plane, plane formed by these two vectors. So in this three-dimensional space, suppose we are given this first vector and the second vector. Okay? And then suppose we are given the vector b. Here. And then we can create the parallelogram and something like this. In that case, yeah, the scalar multiple for u, I mean, multiplied by with u will be 2, and v will be also multiplied by 2, so that we can create this parallel, right? And then what about this guy? This point will have like 3 times u and 1 times v, and then the solution will be 3 and 1, right? But in this really large three-dimensional space, we are given these two vectors of u and v, and then suppose we are given the vector v somewhere over here, okay? And then by just only stretching or shrinking these two given vectors of u and v, so yeah, this one is called a1, and this one is called a2. And think of these two vectors that are given in our linear system in the left-hand side, and then if we if our b vector is found outside of this plane, okay, then can we create the parallelogram that has that that point as our as the vertex of our parallelogram? It is not possible at all, right? Because we can only stretch out the first or the second vector, or yeah, we can also shrink down the length of the given vectors. But we cannot change the vector direction, right? So the resulting linear combination will always be contained or included in this plane, right? Stretched out by our two given vectors. Okay? So if our vector b here is found outside of this plane, okay, and then we cannot find the linear combination coefficient, okay, which means that regardless of any values or regardless of how much we stretch or shrink the given vectors, we cannot make that point at all, right? So that means this linear system has no solution at all, right? So, we studied the condition about when our linear system has no solution at all, right? So what was that? After creating echelon form, if we find like this kind of row, right? And then this is when we have no solution at all, right? But when viewing our linear system as this vector equation of creating our parallelogram, by freely stretching or the shrinking the each vector that are given, okay? So if this vector b is a outside of this plane, okay, and then that's when we have no solution at all, okay? So this situation is exactly equivalent to having this this kind of row in our echelon form, okay? If they are just the equivalent case, okay? So the vector equation is actually exactly the then you now have the basic idea about when we have no solution at all in this three-dimensional space. Then, if this point is falling inside of this height, this plane, okay, that is formed by stretching out u and v, or given vector of an a1 and a2. Yeah, if this b vector, yeah, b is falling inside of this plane, and then can we say that we have a solution? Okay, can we say so? Or if this b vector is actually inside of this blue plane, then can we find the scalar multiple that creates our parallelogram? The answer is yes, right? So we can always create the parallelogram, right? And that means we can always find the proper or suitable scaling factor to make this parallelogram, right? So the question of whether we have a solution or not, okay? So that is actually the same as whether this b vector is inside of our plane stretched by these two vectors, given vectors, or if it is an outside of this plane, and then this is when we have no solution. Right? Okay. So in this case, we can consider this blue plane. Okay. This blue plane is called a span of a1 and a2. Which is our two given vectors. Then the span is the formal definition of the span is all the possible vectors that has the form of linear combination of a1 and a2 with the scalar multiple of x1 and x2. So, suppose we can freely choose x1 and x2, even before thinking about the given b vector here, okay? So we are not given this vector b yet, okay? So we now think about all the possible linear combinations of these two given vectors, okay? So one vector is 1, 2, 5, then another vector is 2, 3, 4, okay? And then let's think about this different linear combination coefficient. So what if we have 1 and 1? And then the resulting vector is 3, 5, 9, right? So that will be corresponding to so this one is A1 and A2. Then it will be corresponding to this one, right? And then we have 0 and 1 here, and then this point, 2, 3, 4, would be another linear combination vector by using the coefficient as 0, 1. And that vector is 0, 1, right? So it will be here. Right? So that is the resulting point after we obtain or compute this linear combination of these two vectors. So we freely change these two values, okay? And then we can collect this point and maybe this point when using the linear combination coefficient as 2, 2, then maybe this point as 3, 1, maybe this point as 2, 0. And then of course we can use the negative linear combination coefficient like -1 and -1. In that case, how can we obtain that? So we just reverse direction of the vector, then also the direction of this vector. Then we have another point here, right? So you can think of this blue plane as the collection of all the possible points that has the form of this linear combination of these two given vectors, a1 and a2. Okay? So again, collecting all the possible linear combination vectors by freely changing these two coefficients, and then collecting all these resulting vectors, then that subset of the vectors are called span of these two vectors. So we basically freely stretch or shrink the given vectors, and then pick up the point and then include it in our space. That way, we can we can completely cover up this blue plane. Okay, so that blue plane is called the span of these two given vectors a1 and a2. So let me just give one last comment. So let's now think about the vector b. So vector b is inside of the span of a1 and a2, and that means b falls inside of this blue plane. And that's when we have the solution. Okay, but b is not inside of the span. Okay, and that's when we have no solution, or that is corresponding to the case of having the vector b outside of this blue plane. Okay, so we can now think about this existence, or whether we have a solution or not, in terms of this span of these given column vectors in our linear space. Okay, so that's it for today. So you guys know that the homework was posted, right?